reason for this great season of sin to lost it somehow. All those memories from long ago centuries, do they still matter now? If the birth of a king that led angels to sing is to bring us joy and good cheer, could our hearts hope again? Will there be Christmas right here? See the family gathered around the tree. Oh, what joy it can bring. See their loving hearts giving, taking part. Is this why we sing? Yet remember the night that God gave us his light. It's the reason our family's here. Seek him now once again, and we'll find Christmas right here. Though the giving and feasting and holiday greetings this time sets our faces aglow, yet the greatest of gifts do we know. He was born of a virgin to show us our need for believing, forgiveness receiving, and fullness of life he will bring. And without him we empty would be, for you see Christmas, it's all about Jesus. Oh, he's the reason for this great season. Rejoice with us, come and sing. Hope he brings us his gift, has freed us to celebrate him as our King. May we never forget of the birth where we met the Son who brought joy and good cheer. Celebrate him again, and we'll find Christmas welcoming Jesus. Yes, we'll find Christmas.
Heavenly Father, tonight, help us lay aside the chaos and marvel at the mystery and wonder of the birth of our Savior, Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah.
Everywhere, go tell it on the mountain. Jesus
Jesus, the price is mine.
It is the story of Jesus, heralded in all of Scripture, that we are to go and tell. God's promise to the world has been fulfilled. What a miracle! Jesus came down from heaven to save our souls. He came to rescue us. This salvation was the focus of the prophets, who prophesied of this outpouring of grace that was destined for you. They made a careful search and investigation of the meaning of their God-given prophecies as they probed into the mystery of who would fulfill them in the time period when it would all take place. We have hope because of God's love for us, His created beings. In the first chapter of John, verse 1, He speaks of an eternity past, a beginning before time existed. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with Him in the beginning. All things were created through Him, and apart from Him, not one thing was created. Life was in Him, and that life was the light of men. That light shines through the darkness, and the darkness did not, will not, overcome it.
Song still rides the song of a redeemed.
God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. But it wasn't until the fourth day that he created the sun, moon, and stars. What then was the light? Well, certain theologians have said that it was never just physical light, but perhaps the kind of light that you can know. The light of knowledge that can be examined. The light of law, the light of love. And in the phrase, "let there be light," God was announcing order. He was essentially introducing himself to us and binding himself to us. His glory streams out from himself and streams back in many ways, especially when he is treasured and enjoyed by his people. Our universe, the totality of the cosmos, continues to expand to this day because he spoke it into being and has never called back his words. His purpose continues. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And even when Adam and Eve, made in his very image, who walked and talked with God in the garden, believed the lie of Satan, God unveiled his plan to restore them. He cursed the serpent and said, "I will put hostility between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He will crush your head and you will only strike his heel." Their love of self had become more important than their love of God. So he made a covenant of blood and covered their self-aware nakedness with the skins of animals. Their disobedience had brought death to the world. We too know the truth of God, but often choose to suppress it in our hearts. But in our proud suppression, we cut ourselves off from God and from joy. Even when our disobedience brought much sorrow and great conflict, he revealed that he himself, through his Messiah, would come to deliver us at the appointed time. In all of the Old Testament, he spoke of his plans. And then there was a pregnant pause.
From the creation of the world, God loved us. In the warmth of a sunrise, in the rainbow after a storm, through signs and wonders, promises and dreams. He showed his love through the law, through judges and prophets and kings, through floods, famines, furnaces, and fish. He parted the waters, led nations to new lands, closed the mouth of lions, and rained down fire from heaven. But in all that he had done, we still did not understand the great mystery of his love. So he did something we never imagined. He grew silent. But in the silence, he was preparing us. into the very presence of God on a quiet night in Bethlehem, the earth shook with a heavenly host, announcing the good news that would change the course of eternity. God's only Son, perfect and holy, would come down to dwell among us. But how would he come? A brave warrior like Joshua? A triumphant king like David? A bold prophet like Elijah? No. In God's infinite kindness, he chose a humble baby, our infant God, here with us. This is the mystery of Christmas. And now our hearts are bursting with joy. Like the star that scattered its light across the night sky, our voices ring out in praise. We join with the angels and sing.
Good news. God has published his son's birth announcement. Nothing in the universe is more central than the radiance of the glory of God revealed in Christ. All through the centuries, Israel had waited. And now he was inviting everyone to come and see what he had done. The heavens declared his Messiah's birth. God never has casual relationships with things or people. They're always serious, always binding. Even foreign kings were led to worship this godchild. And for Simeon and Anna, who had so faithfully worshiped and waited for him in his temple, it was granted to see with their own eyes the salvation of God, his promised deliverer. Now for all mankind. Simeon's name even means he who hears. The Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Spirit that he would not see death until he saw the Lord's Messiah. In Luke 2, it tells us that, guided by the Spirit, he entered the temple complex. When Mary and Joseph brought in the infant Jesus to perform for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him up in his arms, praised God, and said, "Now, Master, you can dismiss your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation. You have prepared in the presence of all people a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel." His father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said, "Indeed, this child is destined to cause the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed. and a sword will pierce your own soul, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Mary knew it, and she knew that he was born to die for our salvation. The precision and plans of God are astounding. The evidence is all around us, in nature, in our exact distance from the sun, the tilt of the earth for its seasons. It's also written in the Word of God, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, you are small among the clans of Judah. One will come from you to be ruler over Israel for me. His origin is from antiquity. His origin is from eternity. And so the Lamb of God was born for us in the city of David. God didn't create the universe out of boredom, but out of a desire to be loved to his created and to have a relationship with us. It was his plan from the beginning that we would be with him. The long winter of our souls has ended, and we who have believed in this message will enter his rest. The angels heralded this newborn Savior. Let us join them in this proclamation. Hark, the herald angels sing. Now we with them sing of this wondrous mystery. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. We have seen Jesus, who is the visible expression of the invisible God. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. He rules the world with truth and grace. Truth which directs the mind and grace which melts the heart. Far as the curse is found, what joy! We now live out the realities of his sacrifice, the blood which paid for all our sins, and we will be raised with him in glory. Death, where is your sting? Hallelujah!
God appear, our salvation draw.
fall down and worship the King. Praise to the one who redeems. We sing his praise. In the Psalms, we are commanded more than 200 times to make music to our God. And our worship goes far beyond the glorious wonders of music. There isn't a culture on the globe that doesn't worship. German archaeologist Klaus Schmidt said that the world's oldest temple suggests that the urge to worship sparked civilization. The site confirms what God's law has stated all along, that we need to worship, to have something in which we put our ultimate trust, as if our need to worship was as important as our need to breathe. Worship doesn't just give purpose to our lives. Worship is life, and none of us can avoid it. The question we must all ask ourselves is, who or what do we worship? If not the God of the universe, then who? Jesus told his disciples that he is the way, the truth, and the life. If our trust is not in him and in the inerrant word of God, then in what do we trust and offer our allegiance? All else will fail. He calls us to go beyond the arguments and the substitutes to the bare truth. The choice is ours. May we worship the King.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets formed. If the stars are made to worship, so on a hill you created, the light of the world abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you
creation still obeys you, so will I. If you gave your life to love them, so will I. God's first commandment instructs us to have no other gods before him. Jesus confirms this by telling us to love God with all our hearts, all our souls, and all our minds. In other words, with every part of our being. His second commandment is the outworking of the first, to love our neighbors as ourselves, to pour out our lives in service to him, even unto death, if necessary. When we have surrendered our lives to Jesus, his Holy Spirit takes up residence in our hearts and directs our lives. We are to cast our burdens on him because he cares for us. He will never forsake us. And if he leaves the 99 in search of the one who is lost, shouldn't we? We are the ones bringing the good news now. Now we can love with his love by the Holy Spirit within us. We have a grand narrative to which we can bind ourselves to, of God's love for his creation. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has now shone in our hearts to give the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Even angels long to look into these things. God took the initiative. How will we respond? Just as Simeon and Anna were so faithful to wait for Jesus' first coming, let us be alert and faithful to wait for his second, for Jesus is coming. He may tarry, but it will be as sudden as a thief in the night, for he is coming. We, his people, are the very theme of his song. May we always be the theme of his. Noel, let us sing Noel.
So dear, sing God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Oh, come.
Oh, come, all who are weary and all who long for peace. Be gladdened by this good news. He's come to set us free. Emmanuel, our God with us, will rescue and redeem. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, joy, joy to the world, the Lord is come.
Sing with us, church.
Prophet Isaiah said, and still says down the corridors of time, seek the Lord while he may be found. Draw to him while he is near. He is near. He's here.
There's no reason for this great season of sin to lost it somehow. All those memories from long ago centuries, do they still matter now? If the birth of a king that led angels to sing is to bring us joy and good cheer, could our hearts hope again? Will there be Christmas right here? See the family gathered around the tree,
what joy it can bring. See their loving hearts giving, taking part. Isn't this why we sing? Yet remember the night that God gave us His light. It's the reason our family's here. Seek Him now once again, and we'll find Christmas right here. Though the giving and feasting and holiday greetings this time sets our faces aglow, yet the greatest of gifts do we know. He was born of a virgin to show us our need for believing, forgiveness receiving, and fullness of life He will bring. And without Him we empty would be, for you see Christmas, it's all about Jesus. Oh, He's the reason for this great season.